Morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Well, that was kind of weak. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Awesome. Much better. Thanks. Great morning to come to church, so we're glad everybody's here. So for announcements this morning, I want to start off by saying we have the Joyful Noise Choir here with us throughout the service, which means that we're going to have a lot of different people within the congregation coming out and playing the handbells and playing the pianos and whatnot. And there is also stuff in the pews for what I would consider to be audience participation. Also tonight at 4 o'clock, Joanna?
4 o'clock.
First, what I would call the introductory meeting for the youth group for grade 6 and up.
Grade
6 and up from 4 to 6. So all of your kids getting back in here at 4 o'clock, because my girls are eagerly awaiting. The other thing that I wanted to talk about as well is this morning we're going to, this afternoon actually, starting at around 11:15, we're going to have a memorial service for Gordon McCann, who, as many of you know, was a former lay minister here and long time member of the church. So we're going to start at 11:15 with what we're calling a preception, and then ultimately we will have a memorial service that starts noonish, right around noon. Let's see, I went over that. Yep. We're looking for you good volunteers for a variety of things around the church that need to get done. Rex and I volunteered our skills yesterday and cleaned out a bunch of stuff, so that's never a bad thing. But nevertheless, for those of you who want to get involved in doing things, that would be awesome. And then also I wanted to announce the All Spring Cleanup that's on May the 14th. Remember, many hands make light work, so we're going to give this place a really good spring cleaning. And I believe that starts at 9 o'clock-ish, and we'll have a suitable breakfast stuff, donuts and coffee, I believe will be supplied as well. Let's see, anything else? Last but not least, as part of our Church World Service ministry, we have the blanket drive for Mother's Day that's coming up. Members of the Mission Social Action Committee will be selling Mother's Day cards and receiving donations in the narthex following the services on both May the 1st and May the 8th. Each donation of $10 will allow a Church World Service to purchase a locally produced blanket to be distributed throughout the world. A lot of the supplies, if you will, that are being donated now are going specifically to Ukraine to help with all of the terrible things that are happening in that country. So that's it for this morning. Thanks.
Thanks so much, Dave. Appreciate that. I wish I had Dave's booming voice. Doesn't need a microphone. All right, well, let's sing together, shall we? Number 283 in your New Century Hymnal, 283, Spirit of the Living God. Thank you. the vault of heaven.
Praise God in the earth's stars.
Sing praises to the Lord.
Shout and sing praises to God.
We have witnessed God's mighty acts.
We have seen the Lord's greatness.
Let everything that breathes praise the Lord.
Let everything that draws breath praise the Lord.
Amen. You may be seated. So when we offer our confession, we join the beautiful work of reconciliation. It's such a beautiful word, reconciliation, which begins with us reconciling with God, trusting in our partner of grace, letting go of all that is amiss and remiss within us, giving it to God and resting in God. Knowing God forgives, because that's God's nature. So let us do this in sacred silence as we begin a time of confession. Peace of God be with you. Receive God's forgiveness and the promise of the Spirit, for Jesus is risen. Seen or unseen, he is present in our midst, and we see the presence of Christ reflected in each other's faces. Happy are those who have not seen, yet have come to believe. Amen. Amen. Our Sabbath poem is pretty well known. I used to be a fan of the TV show ER, and when Alan Alda was on that show for a few seasons, he recited this poem. That's where I first heard it. It's now one of my favorites. It's by Wendell Berry. It's called Peace of Wild Things. When despair for the world grows in me, and I wake in the night at the least sound, in fear of what my life and my children's lives may be, I go and lie down where the wood drake rests in his beauty on the water, and the great heron feeds. I come into the peace of wild things, who do not tax their lives with forethought of grief. I come into the presence of still water. I feel above me the day-blind stars, waiting with their light. For a time, I rest in the grace of the world and am free. Amen.
Good morning, everybody.
Morning.
So I wanted to explain why there are instruments in the pew. And I would encourage everybody that there's two on each end of the pew. If you have more than two people in your group, can you go to a pew that nobody's in and grab instruments so everybody has an instrument? If you could take a moment to do that, that would be great. Maybe people could help passing them out if needed. We're going to have the Joyful Noise Choir. We get together on Sunday morning. We rehearse. It's a small amount of time. We do great things with it. But we want to invite you in as well. And so the audience part has two parts. If you are on this side, you will be playing with these fine people over here. And you're going to be playing this. That's two. Can everybody over this side join me? One, two, can you grab an instrument? There you go, okay. I don't have an instrument here, so I'll pretend this is the right instrument. One, two, three, four, one. Let's see. Good, so every time these people over here do do let's be, you'll do it with them. Okay, you'll get the passion. Over here, we are born again. So this side over here, can you do that pattern maybe? 1, 2, 3, 4, 1. Born again. Good. Let's try that. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1. 1, 2, and 1. Born again. Good. There we go. You'll catch up. It's a lot of fun. Do we have everybody else? Yes, we have our fantastic instrumentalists. Let's give it a go.
Remember The earth is the only one we got, and we need to take care of it. Earth Day is as old as I am, so that's another reason I sort of enjoy it. But there's a spiritual meaning behind Earth Day that I think you should all know. There's this thing that theologians like to talk about. You know what a theologian is? Someone who studies God, talks about God. Someone who talks about God. Theology is God's talk. And a theologian is a God talker. So God talkers like to talk about this thing called general revelation. General revelation. Big term, right? Anybody have an idea what it means? No? No, of course not. What it basically means is that God reveals God's self in nature by God's creation. God created the universe, and in that universe, we can understand God a little bit. We can see God in some way. God is invisible, but God's creation isn't. So we can see some of God in creation. Not all of God. No one can see all of God. That has to wait till we're in heaven. But we can see a little of God in God's creation. Have you ever seen a painting that you really like? No, you've never seen it. That's kind of a silly question, isn't it? Everyone's seen a painting. But have you ever thought about painter painting that painting? There's a little bit of that painter in what you see as the final result. That painting includes some of the painter in the painting. The same idea goes for creation. We see the universe, the beauty of it. We see this flower. It's so intricate, beautiful, colorful, complex, and how it grows and how it comes to be. In springtime, we see colors all around us. The earth is beautiful. And so we see some of God in the earth. We see God's beauty, especially this time of year. So that's the idea of general revelation. We see a bit of God in God's creation. We also see more of God in Christ. And that's specific revelation. And we'll talk about that another time. But for now, because of Earth Day, remember the term general revelation. God reveals God's self in creation. And we can learn a little more about God by seeing it and appreciating it and being grateful for it. And so that's a good thing to remember as we come out of Earth Day. All right? Sound good? All right, you can follow your teacher. And we'll sing out. Thank you. Thanks so much, Norma. Talk about intricate. That's an intricate piece. Wonderful job. We're going to have a special reader of the psalm this morning. Thanks, Sue, for reading.
I'll be reading Psalm 118, verses 14 through 29. God is my strength and my song. God has become my salvation. Raise shouts of joy and victory in the tents of the upright. Yahweh's right hand is doing mighty acts. Yahweh's right hand is winning. The Lord's right hand is doing mighty acts. No, I will not die. I will live to proclaim the deeds of Yahweh. Though Yahweh has disciplined me often, I am not abandoned to death. Open the gates of justice for me. Let me come in and thank you, Lord. This is the gate of Yahweh, and only the upright can enter. Thank you for hearing me, for saving me. It was the stone which the builders rejected that became the keystone. This is the Lord's doing, and it is wonderful to see. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us celebrate with joy. Please, Yahweh, please save us. Please, Lord, give us prosperity now. Blessings on the one who comes in the name of the Lord. We bless you from the temple. Yahweh is God, and God has enlightened us. Join the festal procession with palm fronds in hand. Go up to the horns of the altar. You are my God, and I thank you. You are my God, and I exalt you. Thank you for hearing me, for saving me. Thank you, Lord, for your goodness. Your love is everlasting.
Thanks so much, Sue. Beautiful psalm this morning. For our gospel reading, we turn to the Gospel of John, chapter 20, verses 19 to 31. It was still the first day of the week. That evening, while the disciples were behind closed doors because they were afraid of the Jewish authorities, Jesus came and stood among them. He said, "Peace be with you." And after he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. When the disciples saw the Lord, they were filled with joy. Jesus said to them, "Peace be with you. As the Father sent me, so I am sending you." Then he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, they are forgiven. If you don't forgive, they aren't forgiven." Thomas, the one called Didymus, one of the 12, wasn't with the disciples when Jesus came. The other disciples told him, "We've seen the Lord." But he replied, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands, put my finger in the wounds left by the nails, and put my hand into his side, I won't believe." After 8 days, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Even though the doors were locked, Jesus entered and stood among them. And he said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here, look at my hands, put your hand into my side, no more disbelief. Believe." Thomas responded to Jesus, "My Lord and my God." Jesus replied, "Do you believe because you see me? Happy are those who don't see me and yet believe." Good news, thanks be to God. O God, may the reflections of my heart and the words of my mouth be pleasing to you. Amen. I'm not sure if this qualifies as a confession. I don't think it does. But of all the disciples of Jesus, the Apostle Thomas is the one I most identify with. Yes, Thomas. The doubter. He's the disciple closest to my heart and my way of being. Is that a surprise to you all? Maybe. Shouldn't a pastor be more akin to John, often dubbed the beloved disciple, or Peter, the strong-willed shepherd of the church, or even Andrew, the faithful one who literally brings folks to Jesus? Thomas, the doubting one. Not the disciple one would choose necessarily as the pastor's favorite. So why is Thomas my favorite disciple? Because by nature, believe it or not, I'm a skeptic. Did you know that about me? I'm a skeptic. I'm not a completely trusting person when it comes to things I see and experience. I mull things over, I ponder possibilities, I try to decipher the how, the what, the why of things. I seek proof and am hesitant to believe the incredulous. I need to test hypotheses and truth claims. It's the way I am, the way God made me. And I think Thomas was exactly like this. At the same time, and I hope this is true for me, Thomas was someone whose reservoir went deep. He was not a surface-level kind of guy. He thought deeply and felt deeply. And once he internalized a truth or a friendship or God deeply, he devotedly spread that truth, was a friend for life, and was devoted for life. Maybe you didn't know this about Thomas, but he was the only disciple to bring the gospel of Christ outside of the lands of the Roman Empire. The only disciple to do this. He famously ventured as far east as India, planting Christianity in that faraway land in a very different culture. Thomas' Christianity continues to this day. It's one of the oldest continuous Christian communities in the world, almost as old as the Roman Church. Our reading from the Gospel of John this morning tells the familiar story of Thomas's journey to believing in this bold proclamation of Jesus' bodily return after being dead for three days. The narrative shows Thomas as a skeptic who Jesus needs to put in place, in his place. The story ends with Thomas being reprimanded for his doubt as being part of a second tier of believers, kind of. One who believes, but after testing things first, as opposed to one who believes without testing things first. The Gospel of John is the only gospel that tells this story, and Thomas is not really mentioned anywhere else outside of the Gospel of John. He's kind of invisible in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. And when Thomas is mentioned, he's mentioned a couple other times in John, he's often put in a negative, disbelieving light. He's the only disciple called an unbeliever. Not even Judas is called that. Scholars debate what's going on here. Why does John put Thomas in such a negative light? There's a school of thought that says the Gospel of John, especially this story, is best seen as a response to another gospel floating around at the time, the Gospel of Thomas. Yes, that Gospel of Thomas. It became all the rage a couple of decades ago. The Gospel of Thomas is not in our Bibles, but it is one that is as old as John, if not older. It doesn't seem so heretical, so scholars wonder why it's not included. It aligns, for the most part, with the four Gospels in our Bible, as well as with the other parts of the New Testament, especially Paul's writing. Where the Gospel of Thomas diverges most, and likely why it's not included in the Bible as part of the canon, is that the Gospel doesn't mention the crucifixion or the resurrection. At least Mark mentions both, with the resurrection being very small in its narrative. But Thomas doesn't include it, but instead focuses on the teachings of Jesus, only on the teachings of Jesus. In fact, the Gospel of Thomas is all teaching. It's full of gospel, it's a gospel of Jesus' sayings, and that's all. But here's the thing we often miss when reading the Gospels. Each Gospel, including the Gospel of John, comes out of a local community of believers. The Gospel of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and even the non-canonical Gospel of Thomas, comes out of a community, a local community from which it was written. And the community of believers from which the Gospel of Thomas was written was a community that did not assert the bodily resurrection of Jesus. It asserted the unconquerable, victorious presence of Christ after the crucifixion, a presence that death couldn't keep down, but a presence that after the crucifixion wasn't fully bodily as we understand it. The community of believers from which the Gospel of Thomas came out of, simply put, didn't believe in the bodily resurrection of Jesus, but to the spiritual reality of Christ, which was experienced firsthand and powerfully after Christ died on the cross. I guess the takeaway here is there was a diversity of thought around even the resurrection in the earliest days of the church. Even the Bible we have, without mention of Thomas, points to this. Biblical scholar Elaine Pagels, professor of religion at Princeton University, points this out. She writes, "Some biblical accounts of the resurrection tell how Jesus appears to his disciples in the form they know from his earthly life. He eats with them, invites them to touch him, to prove that he is not a ghost. Jesus tells a similar story. Thomas declares that he will not believe that Jesus had actually risen from the grave unless he personally can see and touch him. When Jesus appears, he tells Thomas, 'Put your finger here and see my hands, and put out your hand and place it in my side. Do not be faithless, but believing.' But other stories, directly juxtaposed with these, suggest different views of the resurrection. Luke and Mark both relate that Jesus appeared in another form, not his former earthly form, to two disciples as they walked on the road to Emmaus. Luke says that the disciples, deeply troubled about Jesus' death, talked with the stranger, apparently for several hours, the stranger being Jesus. They invited him to dinner. When he sat down with them to bless the bread, suddenly they recognized him as Jesus. At the moment he vanished out of their sight, John 2 places directly before the story of doubting Thomas, another of a very different kind. Mary Magdalene, mourning for Jesus near his grave, sees a man she takes to be the gardener. When he speaks her name, suddenly she recognizes the presence of Jesus, but he orders her not to touch him. So if some of the New Testament stories insist on a literal view of resurrection, others lend themselves to different interpretations. Paul describes the resurrection as a mystery, the transformation from physical to spiritual existence. Unquote. Yes, our story from the Gospel of John clearly asserts what became the Orthodox view. But both the New Testament and the earliest Christian communities the New Testament came out of held a diversity of views when it comes to the resurrection. And I think this is okay. As for me, I must confess, and I guess this is a real confession, I remain skeptical about Jesus' bodily resurrection. It's the scientist in me, I guess. This doesn't mean I don't celebrate and preach Easter as a spiritually meaningful truth. I believe the disciples were genuinely transformed by their experience of Christ's spiritual presence in the wake of his death. As a hospice chaplain, I saw firsthand how death, grief, and the afterlife can be beautifully mysterious and transformative, even out of that mystery. And it is the transformation in the lives of Jesus' followers that was as true can be. That transformation matters most. The transformation is true. For those who experience the resurrected Jesus directly, according to the Gospels, and those who did not, who were the vast majority of followers according to the Gospels, it is the transformation they both groups of people experienced that matters most of all. It is a transformation that gave way to the church, the visible, lasting body of Christ here on earth. It is a transformation that explains why we are here. For this, we celebrate and will keep celebrating. As for Thomas and the Thomases among us, well, they are welcome here too. Amen. Let us sing together the hymn I learned as a kid in church, Seek Ye First. Service where we get to share of what's going on in our lives, both the good and the bad, and maybe the ugly, our joys, sorrows, concerns. Anybody that would like to share? Yes, Teresa?
Bev and Harv are in California right now, and Bev asked for prayers for her cousin Tommy.
Cousin Tommy going into back surgery. That and hers, cousin. Okay, anybody else? Oh, I'm sorry. Beth?
Prayers for the family of my aunt, Neil Robinson, who died this morning.
Oh, I'm sorry. Your aunt, you said? Yeah, sorry. Passing away Beth's aunt. Anyone else?
I have a joy. It's going to be a joy to sing with the Plainville Choral Society having their first in-person concert in the last 2 years.
Uh-huh.
It's going to be the end of May. If anybody's interested in coming and getting tickets, let me know.
Right. Choral Society of Plainville, Alan's part of it. They're having their first concert after a while. Good news. I think we're going to that. Anybody else? Oh, I'm sorry.
I have two that reminded me of a joy. I got to play with the Bridgeport Symphony yesterday, and it was just an absolute joy to be back in a real orchestra after 2 years of not. And my prayer request is for my kids who are struggling, and that the district would do the right thing by them.
Jack is part of the Bridgeport Symphony. They have their first concert. What's that?
Just this week.
Okay. And Jackie's kids having parents for school and them in school. Anybody else? Okay. Let's pray. O God, who is love, we hold in our hearts and in the light of your precious love those who need our care and support this morning, those who are ill, those who are facing surgery or various procedures, those who suffer in whatever way, whether it be bodily, mentally, spiritually, psychologically, those who feel lost and alone, dismissed or discarded, those who feel they've been wronged, those who've been bogged down by the hardships of life, those who struggle with just getting by, worried about the next paycheck and the bills that are piling up. And for those who grieve in ways that are various, but most notably in the wake of a loss in the family, a passing away of loved ones. We lift all these things before you, knowing you are a God who hears us and sits with us through it all. We pray for wholeness and healing all around and rooted in you, the God who is love, light, and breath. We acknowledge the reality of racial hatred, economic exploitation, militarism, and war, what Dr. King called the three evils. We acknowledge how these evils ruin lives, and so we pray for your compassion to be realized in the world and actualized in the hearts of human beings. We also celebrate this Orthodox Easter day with those experiencing joy and contentment in their lives despite all the pain. We together with them say thank you, knowing a spirit of gratitude is the source of all joy and contentment. As we hold all these things deep in our hearts and in the light of your love, O God, in Christ, we are grateful for the miracle of togetherness and for the grace of your infinite compassion. Help us to retain a spirit of grace and compassion through it all, and through this week. For it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Pass a plate here at C.C.P., but we do receive your tithes and gifts gratefully through the box we have in the back. So do give as you feel led by the Spirit to give. Please know your gifts sustain and strengthen this place that is sacred to so many, this community which is a community of memory and hope for so many, a community of God's love, knowing we are keepers of God's love as the body of Christ. We are stewards of God's dream. Amen. Let us pray. O God of our salvation, we are witnesses to your amazing deeds and your amazing love. By the resurrection of your Son, you have opened the gates to eternal life. We are grateful for your gifts of forgiveness and a new start. Let the obedience of Christ, the righteous one, become the chief cornerstone of our lives. Help us to use our spiritual gifts and monetary blessings as that it be a testimony to your glory. We dedicate ourselves and our offerings through Christ our risen Lord. Amen. Continue God's holy work. To God be the glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Happy Easter.